atmospheric rivers are called atmospheric rivers for a reason. The volume of water vapor in the atmosphere, if you could somehow put it all on a scale, it would be, you know, similar to that, you know, in some of the largest rivers in the world. And although I haven't seen numbers for this particular storm event that we've had here in BC, it probably was similar to the amount of water in the Amazon.
We are just getting pummeled. Absolutely pummeled.
Atmospheric rivers are basically long, reasonably narrow patches of really moist air that come off sort of the tropics and aim towards, in this case, the west coast of Canada. They're often, hundreds of kilometers wide, which when you think of the scale of the planet is pretty narrow. But they're incredibly long, be up to 5,000 kilometers long. And so all of that warmth and moisture that you find like further south in the Pacific Ocean and in the atmosphere over the Pacific Ocean can get pulled sort of towards Western North America. And it's the reason that here we often call them Pineapple Express storms. Calling it a river, but it is water vapor. It's water in the gas form, and that's got to, you know, condense into become liquid water droplets that come out of the sky. And the reason they cause so much damage here on the West Coast is because the atmospheric river is coming off the ocean and then being affected by the mountains. And so the air is lifting as it comes up over the mountains. And as air rises, it cools off and it makes it easier for clouds to form and water to condense. And so whenever you have storms coming off the ocean into a mountain range, you tend to get very heavy rainfall. And what was so damaging about this particular storm is it kind of funneled right up the Fraser Valley, where you have a big, long river valley surrounded by mountains. And it was a recipe for disaster, really. There are really two parts, I think, to sort of adapting to the reality that these types of heavy rainfall events and potential flood events are becoming more common. The first is just working on warning systems into getting people out of harm's way. I mean, people are trapped on the road because of mudslides without a way to get out and having to sleep in their cars during pretty horrible weather, right? I mean, this is a really dangerous event. That sort of thing can be avoidable through better early warning systems. But the other part of it is about what causes flooding and what causes mudslides and everything is that extreme rainfall doesn't guarantee that flooding is going to happen. Whether flooding happens or not is about how we manage the land, right? And that from everything to forest management practices, you know, making sure the soil's held really well together here and on some of the steep slopes near highways and towns in the interior, to agricultural practices and land use planning practices, where people's homes are and everything, to make sure people aren't living in floodplains, to making sure our floodplain maps are up to date, which is a big problem in Canada. And so there's sort of both the emergency warning part of it, plus the like sort of long-term land use planning part of it. We'll say that it's not a surprise that this is a pretty wet winter on the West Coast. We are in what atmospheric scientists call La Nina conditions, which is like the opposite of an El Nino event. So it's not surprising that we would be having a wet winter. What is surprising is just how intense this rainstorm was. There's been really nothing like this in BC history.